There was the child, there was the bloke responsible, there was the day-to-day routine, there was the bloke responsible, and then there was the hot and hunky workmate. The marriage had hairs on it, and the unthinkable was being thought. But then the bloke responsible seemed worth hanging in there for, so she set about trying to save the marriage.
Phoebe Hutchison has developed her 12 steps to a happy marriage and says that every couple can be honeymooners forever. I hope so. Welcome, Phoebe.
Hello, Phoebe.
Hi, how are you? Good morning.
So can we honestly be that happy forever?
Yes, you certainly can. If that person's a person you fell in love with at the start, you can be at the end, for sure.
What happened to you? I was sort of alluding to it in the
You're
intro.
You're very cute. I like that. Very interesting. Yes, well, basically, in a nutshell, I fell out of love with my partner. I became empty. It basically, everything you can imagine, door slamming, not arguing properly, the whole thing, resentment. It was just terrible.
What was the catalyst, do you think?
The catalyst was having a baby.
Oh,
yes, and
gross.
Being completely unexpected. Don't worry, it won't happen to you.
But well, it might.
No, it won't.
It won't. And basically, yeah, I just had no idea how to be married. I thought that being married was actually something that would be easy. I thought you get married and it's fairy tale, and it was really complicated.
And so what happened? I mean, you had this child. The marriage wasn't the marriage that you thought it was going to be.
That's right.
What happened then? You started to stray?
Well, the worst part for me was I got a crush on a workmate, and that's when I knew, because I was so empty in my marriage, I was reaching out to someone else and talking to them all the time, and that's when I realised I had to do something, because obviously a crush can turn into a full-blown affair. So I decided I need to look at my marriage, and I realised that this other person was nothing. They were just a They weren't even anything as a person. My husband was everything I wanted. So I thought if I could only just feel these butterfly feelings, these honeymooner feelings for him again.
Do you think that happens a lot, though, in marriages? Do you think
I think a lot of people having affairs. Yeah, we look at the stats
on
the website.
Well, not even necessarily affairs. Is yet there. It was more just a crush.
Emotional affairs, crushes. A lot of people are having them all the time. It's because you can't blame them. A lot of people are naive. A lot of people don't understand what's actually going wrong. It's what basically happens.
What's an emotional affair?
An emotional affair is when you're getting all your flirting, all your sparks, all the attention, all the conversation from someone else. So what would happen to me is at the end of the day, my husband would walk in and I'd say, "Hi, doll." And I'd be talking to my guitarist at the time for 45 minutes, and I'd be talking to him, flirting, getting everything from him.
Right. So how were you relating to your husband at that point? It was just were you arguing?
We were arguing. We'd go to gigs because I was a singer back then, and, you know, we wouldn't talk all the way home from a gig. All the things that I've actually put together a book to help, I was doing all the things wrong back then.
So at what point do you go, okay, I'm actually going to work on this now?
I mean, well, it was at the point when I realised I had the emotional affair, and I had to actually say to that guitarist, I had to completely say the whole band was over. So it's a really hard part when you've worked so many months towards a band, you've got gigs lined up. I had to make that decision, and that's what people need to do. If you're having an emotional affair or an affair, you have to say, is it worth it, and make the huge changes in your life.
That must be the biggest point there, though, as you said, because a lot of people, they probably wouldn't even realise that they're having that
emotional
affair.
Well, you're right, that is that point, because I had to sit down there, then I had to call the guitarist the next day and say, I can never see you again, sorry, the band's over, call the other people in the band. I had to make that cutthroat decision, which was really, really hard, but to save my marriage. And I looked at my partner, I thought, he's everything I want.
And make them the focus.
You know, I just want it to work.
So you've discovered 12 steps to making a marriage work. Now, did the 12 steps occur to you? Did you realise the 12 steps were the 12 steps because you were going through them, or did you have to identify these 12 steps in order to get there?
A bit of both, actually, because I had to sit down and strategise and actually work out what I needed to do. So instantly I realised I needed to get some flirting into my marriage, some romance into my marriage, and I needed to get the spark. So I thought, okay, date night. So we started doing date nights. So basically, I'll go through the steps.
Treating your partner like a lover?
Yeah, I started treating him like a lover instead of just the person that was in the house with me. I started treating him really
special. Like you did at the beginning of the relationship, probably.
Like you treat people at work, but even more, you treat them really specially.
And and your partner's suddenly going, whoa, how's this then?
Well, I actually sat down with him and discussed the whole thing with him, so he knew what was happening. I said, we're going to work at this marriage and I'm going to make it work.
Is it because when you're married, you can tend to just take each other for granted after a while, instead of, as you said, treating them the way you would have at the beginning of the relationship?
That's exactly
Or the way you do go out of your way to treat other people?
You do take each other for granted. And this is the thing, and I've spoken to so many women in the 3 years while I put together the book for the 12 Steps, and so many women are saying these things. They're saying, oh, my husband is so annoying, he won't leave me alone. and they're not treating him like a prince and not treating him specially.
The second step was be yourself and allow your partner to be himself.
This is a huge one. A lot of women out there are actually neglecting their partner, neglecting themselves. And if you're not happy in following what you want to follow, your dreams in life, how can you be happy in your relationship? And I know myself, I wasn't being independent at the early stages, so I'd feel resentful. Whereas now I am independent. I just went to America to promote the book and have a good time and have a holiday. And I could do that because I'm an independent woman and I'm happy. That makes a great marriage, being happy and independent.
Yep. There are some of these steps that you've considered to be more effective, perhaps, or
that's right.
Your favourites, let's say. And one of them is the third step, communicate well every day. What does that mean?
Well, this is huge, basically. What we do is we have breakfast together. That's part of communication. It can be having a meal together at night, but certainly, even if you've had a flat-out day and you haven't actually had time to sit down and chat, having that time without the kids when they're in bed and making the time to talk about your day, that's crucial, because 3 days can go past and you're already drifting, and that's when the intimacy goes, and that's what happens in many marriages.
And that's what you said, that's when you seek out other people to talk to instead.
That's right, exactly.
Each other.
I mean, it's all about intimacy and connection, and you need to keep it daily.
Yep. Another point you made is about praising your partner rather than having a go at them all the time and looking for the positives rather than the negatives.
This is a huge one. Yeah, you have to stop fault finding and start praising. So in many terrible marriages, and certainly in mine years ago, I used to constantly pick on him, and I'd tell all my friends about how horrible he was and my family, and constantly bag him, and that gives you a bad gut feeling and that destroys the marriage.
And it must give them an awful feeling too if they think, oh dear, I'm not good enough for her.
Exactly. So what you need to do is turn around and start looking, even if you've got to search really hard, and start seeing those wonderful positives and focus on them, and then it's a mind game. The more positives you see, the more you'll see.
And telling them as well, telling them about
exactly, and telling them. It's just amazing. Praise can do anything, from create a great husband to a great lover. So it really goes everywhere.
So does this create the perfect marriage? I mean, do you no longer have issues? Or
no, I would say I have an awesome marriage, absolutely magnificent. So we are like honeymooners most of the time. Of course, you still have your fights. But when I have a fight, it's quick, it's fast, it doesn't go past a day. We use all the techniques in that argument chapter.
Plan the romance and restore the passion.
Yes, that's fantastic. You need to plan the romance.
But that just sort of, the very thought of that sort
takes
of
takes the spontaneity of it.
Yeah, it makes it, sort of kills it, doesn't it?
Well, I mean,
if you have to plan it.
Funnily enough, the passion actually starts with the intimacy, because many women are actually leg crossers because they're resentful towards their partners. So if you have the intimacy, that's starting towards the passion. But if you're having the date nights, that doesn't necessarily mean passionate night. That means intimate night, whether both of you are having a wine or whatever and really enjoying each other. So, and you can have a date night at home, you don't have to go out. So all that leads up towards the passion. But certainly in the passion, I've got a lot of suggestions in the 12 steps, in the book, where you talk about things that you can do to make it more passionate. And I think you can structure it a little bit, whether it's give and take or whatever.
Now, it's got to be very difficult, though, if you in your passionate life, your romantic life, your sex life, let's say, and it falls into a routine over many years.
That's right.
It must be very difficult to shake it up again then.
Well, I don't think it is. No, definitely not. And I think you've just got to be adventurous. And I'd say to women out there, go outside your comfort zone for more pleasure. And I've got that in the book. I think that's just the most amazing thing. You've got to go outside and understand the male.
That's hard.
Yeah.
That's very hard.
And what the male wants and needs. So just go a little crazy.
Actually,
do some fun stuff.
No, they tend to be a little simple at times. How do you make a marriage work with children then? Because you said having your first child is where the troubles began, but you've had another child since then.
That's right.
So how do you make it work with children?
Well, I like to give them their night. So they've got the Friday night in our house, which is a Friday night kids night. So you have a night where you totally enjoy them. You're having your chocolate and chips.
So your family night.
That's right. And then on a Saturday night, it's more the date night. So they're shuffled off into another room, watching their DVD. You've got your DVD, and you're spending one-on-one time with your partner, which is just fantastic.
Yeah, that's so important, isn't it?
Yeah.
Just finally, this one, argue effectively. How do you do that?
Well, the first thing you do is you follow the 3 golden rules. You don't sleep on arguments, you don't sleep in separate beds, and you never have silent treatments. Now, you can, if you're having an argument, have time to cool down where you go away, as long as you're not resentful and stewing, but you sort it out before the sun goes down.
Because arguments aren't bad, are they? A lot of people think, I'm arguing, my marriage is in trouble. But sometimes you actually need to argue
so you can see what's in your partner's mind. It gives each of you a chance to let out your steam. And if you're not having arguments, then you're building resentment, which is terrible.
You
can have an argument once a week, once every fortnight, who cares? Mm. It's great to get it out. But the main thing is when you're finished arguing, that you have a cuddle and kiss and it's all back to peace. Because it's that resentment that seems to fester inside women in particular that wrecks marriages. Mm. You need to come back to that union together.
Yep. And just quickly, how do you survive an affair?
How do you survive an affair?
Can you survive an affair?
You can survive an affair. I've seen marriages actually survive affairs and it's fantastic.
Must take a lot of work though.
It certainly does. I mean, there's obviously the guilt, but in some cases an affair is just an indication, as I said before, there's things lacking. So if someone has an affair and then they reevaluate their whole life and realise what they wanted was in fact their partner, they can come back. Mm. So many people think it's the end of the world when it's not. I've seen and I've coached marriages back through an affair that are actually have separated and through these techniques come back together and are living together and really like honeymooners. You can, because you've almost lost something that's so special to you, and I almost lost it myself through my emotional affair, so you can.
You just got to always remember why you fell in love with him in the first place, don't you?
Well,
you just never forget
that.
That's right,
you certainly can go through those holding hands, the 10 steps to why you first fell in love with each other.
Mm. Terrific. Okay. Sounds like you've got it worked out. Good on you, Phoebe.
Oh, thank you. Lovely to see you both.
I'll be reading the book.
You too.
Before
Thanks
I,
so much.
Thank you so much.
Before I have this little one. We'll be back with more after this.